Welcome to the Baby Historian. Today we're going to learn why swaddling prevents grandma from freeze-drying her newborn grandbaby, among other verified humoral medical facts. Warning, if you're squeamish about bodily fluids or sex, then this probably isn't the video you're looking for. Humoral theory is a framework for understanding the human body that persisted for at least 2,000 years, with its origins in the ancient Mediterranean world. Hippocrates in the 5th century BCE and Galen in the 2nd century CE are credited with the form the theory took throughout medieval Europe. Many of the ideas grounded in humoral theory, especially those around infancy, persisted into the 20th century, and we still use it today when we refer to something like catching a cold. But keep in mind that very few people in the Middle Ages would have had the care of a physician or surgeon trained in humoral medicine. Even fewer people would have used a physician for pregnancy, birth, or infant care. The majority of people relied on laywomen, most often the matriarch of the family, to deal with health care. And they tended to work with local herbal folkways and natural magic rather than humoral medicine. Humoral theory posits that the human body is composed of four humors. The word is derived from the Greek chemos, which translates into juice. They are blood, yellow bile, phlegm, and black bile. So where did they get this idea? Maybe they watched blood separate, or maybe it's just from the experience of being human. Most of us are aware of blood, phlegm, and yellow bile. We've all been cut, or had a sinus infection, or experienced stomach flu or food poisoning. But black bile? What is that? As someone who's lived most of her adult life with an autoimmune condition but without access to healthcare, let me assure you that if you vomit long enough and hard enough, you'll discover black bile when you run out of yellow. Do not recommend. Thanks, Obama! Each humor had many associations, but to keep it simple, we're going to focus on temperature and humidity. Blood is hot and wet, yellow bile is hot and dry, phlegm is cold and wet, black bile is cold and dry. To explain different sexes and the changes that happen with age, it was believed that women were colder, men warmer, the young moist, and the old dry. It was thought that men and women had the same genitals, but the coldness of the female sex caused the penis and testicles to be inverted in a female.
Oh my God! I'm sorry, I thought this was the baby's room. I'm really sorry.
I was in the pool!
It's all about shrinkage. So what is humoral medicine? In order to have good health, the humors need to be in balance. Then as now, prevention is the best medicine, and a physician would, after determining the unique humoral makeup of a patient, sanguine, choleric, melancholic, or phlegmatic, they would prescribe dietary and lifestyle rules to help keep the body in balance. But when that failed and disease was present, the goal of the physician was to get rid of the excess humors causing the imbalance. If you had a fever with sweating, you obviously had too much of the hot and moist humor of blood, therefore bloodletting was prescribed. And this does reduce a fever, but do not attempt. If you had stomach pain, too much yellow bile, requiring purging through emetics, laxatives, or enemas. Other treatments included intentional blistering through topical preparations, but not all of it was that bad. They also included massage with special oils or herbal baths. Excess humors could build up anywhere in the body, including the reproductive organs, causing all kinds of disease throughout the body. For sexually active people, regular sex was advised to expel excess humors. For men and women, this required regular orgasms. And in the two-seed theory, women needed to orgasm to become pregnant. In the Middle Ages, sex and marriage was considered so important to health and happiness that even women could divorce husbands that failed to perform. Unfortunately, there is no DIY solution. Masturbation was considered not only sinful, but unhealthy, as it was likely to lead to a humoral deficit. But what about people who were sexually mature but not sexually active for whatever reason?
Loser.
How are they to expel excess sexual humors? Become vegetarian. Meat, as the product of sexual reproduction or live birth, was believed to increase carnal lust. Note, the root of the word carnal is carne, which means flesh, i.e. meat. So celibate individuals were discouraged from eating meat, and really eating much of anything at all, to reduce the buildup of humors, and therefore the need to have sex. But as any vegan can tell you, this is decidedly bullshit. Back to the folks getting it on. Infertility or miscarriage would be explained by a woman, never a man, being too cold for seed to grow or too wet for the products of conception to stick. The treatments for this would include dietary and lifestyle changes to put the cold and wet humors into better balance with the hot and dry humors. For example, eating more hot and dry foods, which is not necessarily a description of the temperature or moisture content of the food. For example, kale is hot and dry, but lettuce is cold and wet. You needed a physician to tell you. During pregnancy, it was believed that the fetus didn't have a soul until after the fourth month, which is around the time the mother can feel fetal movement for the first time, also known as the quickening. Before this time, it was believed that miscarriage was more likely. In the Trotula, it is explained that a pregnant woman in need of bloodletting for her own health should not be bled until after the fourth month to prevent the risk of miscarriage. But when the soul is infused into the child, it adheres a little more firmly and does not slip out so easily. And it is still a fact that 80% of miscarriages occur in the first 13 weeks of pregnancy. It was believed that women had control over the sex of her offspring. Women who wanted to conceive a male were instructed to lie on the right side after sex, so the seed would be closer to the liver, which they believed was the source of the body's heat and blood, in order to produce the warmer male offspring. And you know, temperature-dependent sex determination is a thing in biology, just not for humans. And for those who don't know, male sperm is responsible for the sex of offspring. Women's eggs are all X chromosomes, while male sperm contain X or Y chromosomes. X and X create a female, and X and Y create male. Humoral heat was also believed to influence the length of gestation. A woman with an abundance of hot humors might bake her bun to full term at only 7 months, rather than the 9 to 10 of a normal, colder woman. Now, is this true? No. And it's not really clear if physicians at the time thought it was really true either, but it is a convenient excuse to cover up for an illegitimate birth. And physicians needed patrons, just like I do. At the other extreme, a cold climate or season might be the reason for a pregnancy going post-term. This last condition happens to a woman giving birth in the winter when naturally she has a tight orifice of the womb, made more so on account of the coldness of the season, for she is more constricted by the coldness of the air. To induce labor, it was recommended to give the pregnant woman a rub down in hot unguents, such as oil of laurel and oil of linseed and goose or duck or hen's grease. And let the anointing be done from the navel down with the above-mentioned hot unguents. Taking that bacon analogy a bit further, when a baby is born, it's brimming with warm, moist humors. It's like a cookie right out of the oven that needs time to set before it's moved. But unlike a cookie, baby can take a year or more to set up, and in the meantime, it'll get squished from handling. So to ensure straight limbs and body, a freshly born baby will have its arms and legs bound straight and then be burritoed in swaddling clothes and in some cases attached to a board for convenient transport. The swaddling bands not only helped the limbs set properly, they prevented the warm, moist humors from escaping. Every part of its limbs ought to be restrained and joined in bandages, and its features ought to be straightened, that is, its head, forehead, and nose. The belly and loin should be tempered, lest much of the oiliness or humidity exit from them. This was also the rationale for discouraging old people from handling a new baby too much. They'd leach the heat and moisture right out of it. Breast milk was thought to be the same humoral fluid as menstrual blood, converted by the pregnancy. Thus, menses stopped during pregnancy and breastfeeding, and why so many high-born women, professional breeders, had someone else to breastfeed so the blood and fertility would return to their womb. As well as why breast milk was thought to be lacking in quality if the woman providing it started having her period or became pregnant again. Of course, none of this is accurate, but when disease was present in the infant, instead of examining the infant itself, the diet and lifestyle of the mother or wet nurse were considered first. For example, they might be told to avoid food with sharp humors, such as vinegar or tart fruits. because it might cause a humoral imbalance in the baby through the milk. But medieval parents had more to worry about than just tummy troubles. For many of the conditions that would send a modern parent rushing to their pediatrician or an emergency room, a medieval parent had few options within the humoral framework. In many cases, the general consensus was that nothing medical could be done for infants with serious conditions, as the treatments to expel excess humors were considered too dangerous for the infant's body. Thomas Fair described the situation in his 1544 book. The tender babes are oftentimes desolate of remedy, for so much as many do suppose that there is no cure to be ministered unto them by reason of their weakness. It was because of this weakness of infancy and the limitations of their knowledge that the field of pediatrics was one of the last to develop in Western medicine, Fair being the first in England to write a book exclusively on pediatrics. In it, he adapts humoral principles while combining local folkways and natural magic, which had been the province of women healers and mothers before physicians started taking over traditionally women's roles in medicine. For more info on Fair, check out the video linked above and subscribe for future videos. To review, humoral theory was an understanding of the body codified by Hippocrates and Galen, and which persisted for at least 2,000 years in Europe. The goal of humoral medicine was to prevent disease by keeping the humors in balance or by expelling excess humor when it built up and caused disease. However, for sick babies, there was little that could be done within the humoral framework due to their weakness. So thank you for watching, and if you have questions or topic suggestions, please leave a comment or contact me on social media. My links are in the doobly-doo. And if you would like to support this kind of research, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. And once again, please like, subscribe for notification of future videos.